The next topic which we are going to discuss, that is Silent Sentinels, the story of the Megaliths. So what are Megaliths? So in the further chapter, we will discuss about that the people were used to bury, and to mark the burial sites, the big stones were used at that time, and they are called Megaliths. These stones boulders are known as megaliths, literally big stones, as I told you. These were carefully arranged by people and were used to mark burial sites. So they are used to mark burial sites. The practice of erecting megaliths began about 3000 years ago and was prevalent throughout the Deccan, South India, in the Northeast and Kashmir. So the practice of marking the burial site by the megaliths has started about 3000 years ago and was prevalent throughout the Deccan, South India, in the North, East and Kashmir. Some important megalithic sites are shown on map 2, page number 14. So some important megalithic sites are shown on map 2, page number 14. While some megaliths can be seen on the surface, other megalithic burials are often underground. Sometimes archaeologists find a circle of stone boulders or a single large stone standing on the ground. So, while some megaliths can be seen on the surface, other megalithic burials are often underground. Sometimes archaeologists find a circle of stone boulders or a single large stone standing on the ground. These are the only indications that there are burials beneath. And because of the megaliths, they are the indications that there are burials beneath. Here you can see the picture which is given in your book also top. This type of megalith is known as a cyst. Some cysts like the one shown here have portholes which could be used as the entrance, which you can see here the hole for the entrance. There were several things that people did to make megaliths. Several things were there that people did to make megaliths. We have made a list here. Try to arrange them yourself. You can see in the correct order you have to arrange. Digging pits in the earth, transporting stones, breaking boulders, placing stones in the positions, finding suitable stones, shaping stones, burying the dead body. So, first of all, people find suitable stone, they give shape to stones, they dig the pits in the earth, they transport the stones, they break the boulders, they bury the bodies, and they place the stones in the position. All these burials have some common features. Generally, the dead were buried with distinctive pots, which are called black and red ware. So generally, the dead were buried with distinctive pots, which are called black and red ware. Also found are tools and weapons of iron, and sometimes skeletons of horses, horse equipments and ornaments of stone and gold. And sometimes the tools are also found, and the weapons of iron also, and sometimes skeletons of horses, horse equipment and ornaments of stones and gold are also found. Was iron used in the Harappan cities? That we have discussed already in the previous chapter. Here you can see the picture which is given in your book, iron equipment found from megalithic burials. So these equipments of iron are found from the megalithic burials. Left you can see horse equipment, left below you can see axes, and below you can see a dagger that is made of iron. So the next topic which we are going to discuss, that is find out about social differences. So at that time social differences were there. How we can find out? Let's see. Archaeologists think that objects found with a skeleton probably belong to the dead person. So it is the belief of archaeologists that the objects found with a skeleton probably belong to the dead person only. Sometimes more objects are found in one grave than in others. So sometimes more objects are found in one grave. Find Brahmagiri on map 2, page 14. Here one skeleton was buried with 33 gold beads, 2 stone beads, 4 copper bangles and 1 conch shell. So you can find on map 2, page number 14, Brahmagiri. Here one skeleton was buried with 33 gold beads, 2 stone beads, 4 copper bangles and 1 conch shell. Other skeletons have only a few pots. These finds suggest that there was some difference in status among the people who were buried. So it is showing only that there was a huge difference between the people who were buried at that time. Some were rich, other poor, some chiefs, other followers. So some were rich, some were poor, some were chiefs and some were followers. And those who were rich, they were buried with the more objects. Now let's see the next topic, that is, were some burial spots meant for certain families? So some burial spots were also there. Were they meant for certain families only? Sometimes megaliths contain more than one skeleton. These indicate that people perhaps belonging to the same family were buried in the same place, though not at the same time. So it indicates when in one megalith, archaeologists found more than one skeleton, it indicates that the people perhaps they belong to the same family, they were buried in the same place, not at the same time, but after some time. The bodies of those who died later were brought into the grave through the portholes. And what happens at that time? In the graves, portholes were made, so those who were dead afterwards, they were brought into the grave through the portholes. Stone circles or boulders placed on the surface probably served as signposts to find the burial site so that people could return to the same place whenever they wanted to. So the stone circles or boulders placed on the surface, probably they were used to mark that if they will mark that place, so they can return to the same place whenever they wanted to. So the next topic which we are going to discuss, that is a special burial at Imangaon. So what was special at the burial of Imangaon? Let's see. Find Imangaon on map 2, page 14. It is a site on the river Ghod, a tributary of the Bhima. It was occupied between 3600 and 2700 years ago. Here adults were generally buried in the ground, laid out straight with the head towards the north. So you can find Imangaon on map 2, page number 14. It is a site on the river Ghod, a tributary of the Bhima River, and it was occupied between 3600 and 2700 years ago. Here adults were generally buried in the ground, laid out straight with the head towards the north. Sometimes burials were within the houses. Vessels that probably contained food and water were placed with the dead. One man was found buried in a large four-legged clay jar in the country yard of a five-roomed house, one of the largest houses at the site in the center of the settlement. So sometimes burials were there within the houses also. What happened? Vessels were, that probably contained food and water were placed with the dead. One man was found buried in a large four-legged clay jar in the country yard of five-roomed house. So it was the burial at the house. And one of the largest houses at that site, in the center of the settlement. This house also had a granary. The body was placed in a cross-legged position. Do you think this was the body of a chief? Give reasons for your answer. So, this house also had a granary where the burial was there. One, the body was placed in a cross-legged position. Do you think this was the body of a chief? Because so it was buried with so many things, like food vessels were there, and it was the burial at a house which was having four rooms. So you can give reasons for your answer. Let's see the next topic which we discuss, that is, what skeletal studies tell us. Skeletal studies, that means the skeletal which archaeologists found during the excavation. So they study that skeletal also. And what skeletal studies tell us, let's see. It is easy to make out the skeleton of a child from its small size. However, there are no major differences in the bones of a girl and a boy. So it is easy to make out, to recognize that the skeleton is of a child. Because the skeleton of a child will be of small size. However, there is no major difference between the bones of a girl and the boy. So the archaeologist cannot differentiate that the skeleton is of a boy or a girl. Can we make out whether a skeleton was that of a man or a woman? so that you have to search and you have to understand. Sometimes people decide on the basis of what is found with the skeleton. For instance, if a skeleton is found with jewelry, it is sometimes thought to be that of a woman. However, there are problems with this. Often men also wore ornaments. So what happens? Sometimes people decide on the basis when they found the skeletons. For example, if a skeleton is found with the jewelry, so they think that the skeleton is of a woman. However, men also wore ornaments at that time. A better way of figuring out the sex of a skeleton is to look at the bone structure. The hip or the pelvic area of women is generally larger to enable child bearing. So, the better way to figure out the sex of a skeleton is that you have to look at the bone structure. The hip or the lower area, the pelvic area of a woman is generally larger to enable child bearing. Based on modern skeletal studies. So these distinctions are based on modern skeletal studies. About 200 years ago, there was a famous physician named Charak who wrote a book on medicine known as the Charak Samhita. There he states that the human body has 360 bones. This is a much larger number than the 200 bones that are recognized in modern anatomy. Charak arrived at this figure by counting the teeth, joints and cartilage. So 200 years ago, there was a famous physician named Charak who wrote a book on medicine known as Charak Samhita. So he stated that the human body has 360 bones, and Charak arrived at this figure by counting teeth, joints and cartilage. How do you think he found out about the human body in such great details? So we have understood about the burials at Imangaon. So what was the occupations at Imangaon? Let's see. Archaeologists have found seeds of wheat, barley, rice, pulses, millets, peas and sesame. Bones of a number of animals, many bearing cut marks that show that they may have been used as food have also been found. So archaeologists have found seeds of many grains like wheat, barley, rice, pulses, etc. Bones of a number of animals were also found, and many bearing cut marks that show that animals were also used as food. These include cattle, buffalo, goat, sheep, dog, horse, ass, pig, sambar, spotted deer, black buck, antelope, hare, and mongoose, besides birds, crocodile, turtle, crab, and fish. There is evidence that fruits such as bear, amla, jamun, dates, and a variety of berries were collected. So with these animals, the variety of fruits were also collected, like dates and jamun, etc. Now, let's see the conclusion of the chapter. Here you can see elsewhere, find China in your atlas. Take your atlas and find China. Around 3500 years ago, we find some of the first evidence of writing in China. So around 3500 years ago, we found first evidence of writing in China. These writings were on animal bones. These are called oracle bones because they were used to predict the future. So these bones were called oracle bones because they were used to predict the future. Kings got scribes to write questions on the bone. Would they win battles? Would the harvest be good? Would they have sons? So when they have to know the predictions, the kings got scribes to write questions on the bone, like would they win battles and the other questions. The bones were then put into the fire and they cracked because of the heat. Then fortune tellers studied these cracks and tried to predict the future. So when the questions were being written on the bones were put into the fire and because of the heat, they were cracked at that time. So and then the fortune tellers studied the cracks and they predict the future because of this only. As you may expect that they sometimes made mistakes, these kings lived in palaces and cities. They amassed vast quantities of wealth, including large, elaborately decorated bronze vessels. However, they did not know the use of iron. So, the fortune tellers made mistakes at that time. And the kings who used to ask questions So they lived in the palaces and cities. They amassed vast quantities of health, decorated bronze vessels. However, they did not know the use of iron. the kings of Imangao did not know the use of iron. List one difference between the Raja of the Riguved and these kings. You have to list one difference between the Raja of the Riguved and these kings. Here you can see the picture that is of writing of China. You can see which is given in your book. So this was chapter 4, what books and burials tell us, which I have explained you. I hope everything is clear to all of you. If still any confusion is there, so you can ask me on the WhatsApp also. I'll meet you in the another explanation video. Till that, keep learning, stay home, stay safe. Bye bye everyone.